On my right is Howie Halleck. On his right is Glenn Payne. On Glenn's right is Arthur Brown. And on Art's right is Mark Golfus.
We were discussing before an important question had been raised as to whether or not the possibility of asserting that an investment advisor to an investment company controls the investment company by virtue of his investment advisory relationship conflicts with the discussion we had earlier as to whether or not, for purposes of determining the 5% voting stock test in 2A3 A and B, that we would not automatically aggregate holdings of investment companies in the same complex. I don't think it does, and I don't think it does for a couple of reasons. You remember that when we discussed that, we said that we would not assert an affiliation simply because of a 5.1% relationship, because there would be no reason to, but that if the investment companies in the same complex acting through the investment advisor own sufficient securities or by other means could be said to have a type of relationship that we could say could be a control relationship, that we would reserve the right to aggregate. The reason we would reserve the right to aggregate is we would say that these companies were acting through the investment advisor. So far from conflicting with the earlier discussion, I would say that the Stedman analysis complements that discussion because it demonstrates why we would be able to aggregate stock ownership among the various investment companies in a complex to say that that gives rise to an affiliation. Also, there's one of the rules, again, one of the that'll be covered in the subject this afternoon, Rule 17A7, dealing with transactions between investment companies and affiliates, involving this type of transaction, was promulgated to deal with this type of a problem. So as I say, I think Reggie, what we're saying does not conflict. Indeed, if you look at the purpose of why we want to assert an affiliation, it complements what we're talking about. Arthur, did you want to add something to that?
Well, Glenn, I guess part of the question was is important when you're on an inspection of a complex, is whether you should consider the sister investment companies as affiliated persons of one another. And I think Reggie was trying to make, in part, the point that the investment advisor, if the investment advisor is deemed to control the investment company, that the investment companies it thereby controls are under common control and come directly within the 2A3 definition. Now, I'm not certain that we've ever taken that position directly, but I think it does get a lot of support from the Stedman case. And I think in that regard, you can also consider the fact, particularly in a traditional complex where not only is there the same advisor, but there's the same underwriter, and there's the same board of directors, perhaps only with a minor exception, that considering those companies to be under common control, given all those circumstances, not just the advisor, but also the underwriter, and also the directors, that we could consider sister investment companies to be affiliated persons of one another.
I think that's an excellent point. And again, remember, what we were talking about this morning didn't involve a sister investment company relationship. It simply involved determining, again, if you was just to assume a 5.1% share interest, as to whether or not we would want to be asserting a portfolio affiliate relationship. Well, and that is certainly something far different from trying to assert an affiliation on a sister investment company situation. That is, that each investment company is an affiliated person of each other. That is certainly a situation, as Arthur indicated, that we would want to reserve the right to assert the affiliation.
When the commission promulgated Rule 17A7, which exempted transactions among sister companies with respect to purchasing and selling securities, if those securities were sold within the formula set up by the rule, I think the rule stated to the extent that there was an affiliation, they exempted it. There was a recognition there that the only affiliation that could come up was the affiliation of these companies being under common control. That is, either they had the same board of directors, and it's very difficult to determine to say that a company isn't under common control if it has the same board of directors. That doesn't happen by accident. Or that it had the same investment advisor. Now, the point that should be stressed here, however, is that since the investment advisor rarely owns any shares of the investment company, and since the board of directors, even the aggregate amount of shares that the board of directors has, will probably not constitute a 25% of any one fund, then they are under a presumption that they are not in control. But as I stated before, and as Glenn stated before, that presumption can be rebutted by the evidence. And the evidence that a common board of directors of two companies controls those two companies seems to be overwhelming. And I think that in appropriate situations, I have no question that the board of that sister companies are under common control.
Are there any other questions? Any of my colleagues want to add anything on 2A3?
Yes, I want to say something with respect to directors. As we noticed in the chart, the directors can be a director of the directors who are directors of a company are affiliated persons of the company, but the company is not affiliated persons of the director. The question comes up, why did the framers of the act delineate that finally? And a very good answer, I think, is this, and it'll be illustrated in section 17A. If a director, for example, of an investment company is also a director of, say, General Motors, General Motors would not be allowed, the General Motors could not sell its shares in a direct issue to the fund, because if the arrow went both ways, the General Motors would be an affiliated person of the director, who is an affiliated person of the fund, and thereby the fund would be deprived of buying in original issue stock from leading companies. Now, the only way you could do that, the only way that could be resolved, would be not to put members of leading companies on the board. On the board of the investment company. In other words, not to put the director of General Motors on the board of the fund. If that were done, the fund would be deprived of the people who might make the best directors possible, the directors of leading corporations throughout the country, the so-called pillars of industry, would be denied the opportunity, or putting it in its best light, the fund would be denied the opportunity of having these people on the board. And for that reason, the affiliation broke, and the arrow only went one way. Any questions?
Okay. I might add one final point before we go on and analyze the sections, as I said, that 2A3 directly relates to, and that is, when we talked about 2A3E, that is, the investment advisor of an investment company being an affiliated person, you may have noted that E does not make the principal underwriter of an investment company per se an affiliated person. That question does come up quite often. And under 2A3, the principal underwriter, unless you can establish one of the other relationships, the share ownership, the control, or what have you, would not be deemed to be an affiliated person of the investment company. Now, you'll note that one of the results of the principal underwriter relationship not being included in 2A3, Section 17, Section 10F, when they want to apply transactions between the investment company and the principal underwriter or affiliates thereof, have to directly include principal underwriters. They simply cannot deal with or include affiliated persons of investment companies. I think this point becomes clear when we talk about 17 and 10F, but it is important to note that principal underwriters under Section 2A3 are not automatically affiliated persons. With that in mind, I'd like to yield to Arthur.
Thank you. I guess following up on your point and staying within the definitional sections, I'm going to discuss Section 2A19 of the Investment Company Act, which defines the term interested person. Just as with 2A3, this definition really goes to the heart of the regulatory sections 10, 15, and 17, which we'll discuss later on. And just like principal underwriters are omitted from the definition in 2A3 of affiliated persons, there were certain other omissions that became important when you do look at the regulatory sections, particularly 10 and 15, which regulate the relationship of the company with its advisor and the relationship of the board to the company, and Section 17, which relates to prohibited affiliated transactions. Some of these omissions from 2A3 became apparent most clearly in a district court case that was decided in 1963 called Acampara v. Berkland. And in that case, there were a number of violations alleged against an investment company, including that its board of directors was not serving the watchdog function that they were required to, and indeed that the board of directors wasn't constituted in conformance with Section 10A, which required in 1963 that at least 40% of the board be unaffiliated with the company. Well, it turns out that the directors in question were found by the court to be unaffiliated, notwithstanding the fact that one owned 4% of the investment advisor. He had a substantial financial interest in the company maintaining its relationship with the advisor, but as you remember, it's a 5% threshold for affiliation. And here, the director only owned 4% of the investment advisor. The court read the act the way Glenn indicated we do now and said he wasn't an affiliated director. He was one of the unaffiliated directors, one of the 40%. Another acted as the broker for the fund, obviously a source of great compensation, and obviously putting that director in a conflict position. Whether or not he violated his duties was another matter, but he certainly had a conflict because the board would consider quite regularly its brokerage practices and who it would allocate those to. And he was, in fact, receiving a substantial amount of that brokerage. Another, he was therefore found by the court, because there's nothing in 2A3 which makes the broker an affiliated person. It's found to be unaffiliated and could then constitute part of the 40% requirement of unaffiliated directors. A third director did substantial printing work. He owned a printing shop. It was part of his business. And he did earn, I think, fees about $10,000 or $20,000 a year for his printing work on behalf of the fund and the advisor. Well, again, nothing in 2A3 makes him affiliated. There's nothing about business relationships or receiving money alone. The court also found him to be unaffiliated. The Ackam Power case caused some consternation, because the idea in 1940 was really to have watchdogs serve on the board of directors. And here you had people who qualified as watchdogs under the definition of 2A3, but really were people who you would not want to appoint as independent watchdogs without any conflicts of interest. There was a follow-up to the Akampora case in another district in 1964, a lesser-known case called Corin v. Thorpe. And there, you had owners and employees of the regular broker to the mutual fund. Their status was under question, and the court, as you would expect, found them to be unaffiliated, even though in this case the broker did more than a majority of the business for the mutual fund. In addition, one of the other directors, and this is a little more insidious, one of the other directors, in addition to being paid his director's fees, was hired on as an economic or financial consultant by the mutual fund and the advisor and paid a substantial sum. There's no provision in 2A3 for dealing with that kind of conflict. But the court had to hold, therefore, that he was unaffiliated and constituted part of the 40% required unaffiliated board. Both those cases were noted by the commission in its 1966 report, which I'm sure you've heard about already, Public Policy Implications of Investment Company Growth. And knowing those two cases and looking even harder at 2A3, the staff came up with a series of problems, particularly when they focused on the need for independent watchdogs on the board of directors. In addition to the problem of someone who owned less than 5% of the advisor or principal underwriter, they found that people who were affiliated with broker-dealers, particularly regular brokers for the fund, were in a conflict position, but were not considered affiliated directors and therefore were considered watchdogs. They also found the same kind of business relationship that in Corin v. Thorpe one of the directors had with the advisor. He was a consultant, and regardless of the bona fides of the fee that he received and the work he did have a conflict. He was receiving money from the advisor, and in his watchdog status at least had to be questioned under the staff's report. The fourth category, which did not come up in the Akampora or Corin v. Thorpe cases, but which the staff felt was very significant, was a question of relatives of affiliates, so that the spouse of the president of the investment advisor could sit on the board of directors under 2A3 and be considered an independent watchdog. The son, the father, mother, wife, husband could sit on the board and could be included as one of these independent watchdogs. The staff in 1966 was limited to reporting on what they saw as not entirely satisfactory regulatory scheme because of these lapses in controlling the board by controlling who could constitute, in a statutory sense, independent watchdogs. Shortly after 1966, and in large part as a result of that report and the Wharton study, which was done in 1963, legislation was proposed, which eventually got enacted in 1970, effective in 1971, the Investment Company Act Amendments of 1970. And Section 2A19, the definition of interested person, was amended to the Act and made a new section and try to fill these gaps. And in connection with that amendment of 2A19, the term interested person of an investment company was substituted in several sections of the Act for the previously used term affiliated person, so that the Board of Directors, and I'll get to this a little later on in greater detail, now 40% of the board must be not interested persons of the investment company rather than unaffiliated persons of. The watchdog function was significantly strengthened by this amendment. Let me explain what the structure of 2A19 is. First, all affiliates of an investment company are considered interested persons of the investment company. So that everyone who was previously barred from being part of the independent watchdog part of the board continues to be barred. Added to the affiliated person disqualification was any member of the immediate family of any natural person who is an affiliated person of the investment company. That takes care of the son of the president of the investment advisor. Third, interested persons were defined to include interested persons of the investment advisor or principal underwriter. That term is not defined in the Act up till now, but in Section 2A19B, we have a full definition of that term, so we know who that includes. And it includes any affiliate of the investment advisor, so that the president of the investment advisor certainly, even if he doesn't act as an officer of the fund, which is the more normal course, is considered to be an interested person of the company and therefore disqualified. And any member of the immediate family of an affiliate of the advisor or principal underwriter. Third, and this takes care of the case of the 4% owner of the investment advisor shares, any person who knowingly has any direct or indirect beneficial interest in, or who is designated as a trustee for any legal interest in, any security issued either by the investment advisor or the principal underwriter. So that if you have 10 shares, which amount to 0.1% of the investment advisor's stock, you're disqualified as an independent watchdog. You become an interested person of the investment advisor, and therefore an interested person of the investment company.
It's interesting, when this section was first passed after 1970, somebody came in and wanted to discuss with the staff the idea of getting an order declaring him not to be an interested person because he only owned a 1% of the investment advisor. Much less than 1%, as I recall. And he said, it really doesn't make any difference to me that I own this stock. And the director of the division at that time was Sol Friedman, who was a rather blunt person, and he said, it doesn't make any difference to you whether you own the stock or not? He said, and the fellow said, absolutely. He says, why don't you sell it?
Okay. Also included as interested persons of the investment advisor and principal underwriter are its legal counsel and any partner of its legal counsel or employee of its legal counsel. I'll discuss that later as I get back to the definition of interested person of investment company. All broker-dealers and all affiliated persons of broker-dealers are considered interested persons of the investment advisor and principal underwriter. And any person who, by means of a material, professional, or business relationship with either the investment advisor, the principal underwriter, a controlling company of the investment advisor or principal underwriter, or the chief executive officer of the investment advisor or principal underwriter is considered an interested person of such advisor or underwriter, and therefore becomes an interested person of the investment company and disqualified. That takes care of the consultant to the advisor who's receiving a material amount of money. And that's always a matter of fact. But if that amount of money is material, it's material business relationship, he would be considered part of the disqualified board. He would be an interested person of the investment company and could not be counted in as one of the 40%. Now getting, just so, let me backtrack here. Interested persons of investment companies include their affiliates, members of the immediate family of the affiliates, interested persons of the advisor and principal underwriter, which are separately defined in 2A19B. They also include any person who's acted as legal counsel for the company in the last 2 years and any partner or employee of that person. There's an interesting history behind this section because in 1940, counsel to investment companies, who were also traditionally counsel to the management companies, very often did sit on the boards of directors of the companies. And initially, they argued, they would be unaffiliated directors and could be part of the 40% watchdog group. Shortly after the act, I think in 1941, one of these counsel, and I think it was Alfred Jaretsky, who was one of the persons who at Sullivan and Cromwell, who was at the staff during the time of the investment trust study and was involved in the legislation that became the 40 Act, wrote to the commission asking whether he was or was not an affiliated person. I think he alleged that he was not. But the general counsel wrote back that they did consider a counsel to be an employee. An employee of a company is an affiliated person, and therefore he would have to consider himself an affiliated person on the board. This interpretation wasn't crystal clear by any means. The nexus between acting as counsel and being an employee or a quasi-employee is obviously a close interpretive question. And 2A19A4, which is a point we're now discussing, takes care of that problem by specifically referring to counsel and their partners and their employees and making them part of the interested person definition.
Just to stop Mr. Jaretsky from rolling in his grave, I want to make one correction that you said. Alfred Jaretsky wasn't on the staff. He was the industry representative in the negotiations with the staff, which finally brought this act. But I'm sure Mr. Jaretsky, the last thing he ever wanted to be was on the staff of this commission.
I stand corrected. My youth doesn't help in that regard. I think it was Mr. Jaretsky who did pose the question.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Interested persons of investment companies are also defined to include all broker-dealers that are registered under the 34 Act and all affiliated persons of those broker-dealers. Now, this is a very broad part of the definition. Anyone who's affiliated with a broker-dealer is considered an interested person. We're no longer talking, as we did in the Acampora case, of someone who does a regular brokerage for the fund. We're talking about anyone who's in the brokerage business. This, or is affiliated with it, could be a director, therefore, of a broker-dealer, or a director of a company that controlled a broker-dealer. So this part of the section is very broad, brings in a good number of people, and has been the subject of a good number of exemptive orders.
You know the reason?
Yeah, in the Senate and House reports, there was specific, in connection with the 70 Act amendments, there seemed to be no easy solution to this regular broker problem. The broader provision was used, but as part of the compromise, both the House and Senate reports included a specific directive that the House and Senate understood that the Commission had exemptive authority to change the status or to exempt persons from their status under 2A19, and that the Senate and House understood the Commission would be quite flexible in exercising that authority.
There was a lot of discussion as to whether it should be a regular broker, and when they got to what they called regular broker, they didn't know what they were. There was some confusion as to what that meant. So they used the word broker, but the staff in determining whether to give exemptions and looking to the broader reason, recognizes that in an area of brokerage which is constantly changing today, in 1970 we still had third market brokers. Wheaton and Company, for example, was a third market broker that was selling listed securities over the counter at a certain 1/8 to a quarter away from the tape, whichever way, whether you were a buyer or a seller, which under fixed rates was a considerable discount from the investment, from the stock exchange at the price that you would have to, the commission one would have to pay on the stock exchange. If you had a broker there who happened to be affiliated with a member of the stock exchange, his influence may well be to keep the fund going to the stock exchange and thereby benefiting that interest. If he were a third marketeer, an affiliated person of the third marketeer, his influence might be for the fund to seek out the third market and use it more or less to the benefit of himself and his associates. Therefore, we have given exemptions in this area only in very limited situations where the institutional influence was minimal. At one time, the present General Counsel of the Treasury Department was a director of Wheaton and Company, a third market broker. And he wanted to sit on the board of a fund as a disinterested director, and he wanted an exemption. We opposed that. And the fund wanted him on as a disinterested director so bad that they said they wouldn't even deal with Wheaton and Company as long as he was a director of Wheaton and Company. We took the position where that was intolerable. Why shouldn't you deal with the best third market broker in the country? At that time, Wheaton was. At least I think he was recognized as certainly one of the best. So we indicated that we would hold a hearing, and the staff would take the position that we would deny that exemption, and the application, if it were filed, was withdrawn at the time. I can't recall that it was actually filed, but I think this exemplifies the problem of the broker getting in. It looks like a very big, broad definition to exclude a great many people. And it does. But there is a reason for it, because brokerage is probably the biggest single expense that an investment company has to put up with, even though on the books brokerage is capitalized, it is not considered an expense. But speaking broadly, it is an expense, and that broker affiliate has an interest in how the brokerage should go, even though it doesn't go to him, because if he can direct a large investment company to use the third market, or if he can exert influence on that investment company to petition Congress along with others to get to keep the minimum rates rather than to have a mayday, he is helping himself indirectly. I think the discussion continues by Art, there's one thread of commonality to this whole thing, with the possible exception of the brokers, and that is that every person who's disinterested, who's interested here, has an interest in keeping things on the status quo. That every person there would like to see that the same investment advisor remain, because his business is dependent upon that so-called control person. For example, the attorney that is the investment that is now considered an interested person may not be the attorney for the fund if the investment advisor is changed. The printer has a material business relationship with the fund may not have a material business relationship with the fund if a new investment advisor is elected or selected. So when you go down to A19, take a look. Think every one of these people, with the possible exception of brokers, have an interest in the status quo, in things remaining as they are. That doesn't make for independence.
Thanks, Sid. Following up on that, I think really when we talk about the exemptive orders under 2A19, I don't know of any other than those which are exemptive orders from the status of broker-dealers. And in those cases, among other things, we get representations both that the fund will not be doing business with that broker-dealer and that that broker-dealer's taking that broker-dealer out of contention for the fund's brokerage will not do any harm to the fund. That's a very close judgment call which we call on the applicant to make, the investment company to make, and in most cases we haven't had to really challenge it because it's been a situation where it's a broker in bonds only, a specialized broker, and the fund, in fact, is a common stock fund, or it's a regional broker often, and the purchases of the fund are only New York Stock Exchange-type securities, or perhaps only bonds or money market instruments, so that the broker really isn't dealing in the same market as the fund.
I might add just one quick point on that, Arthur. In addition to getting the representation as to the broker-dealer, which the exemption is going to apply to, not doing business for the fund that the application deals with, we also look to, when we're talking about a complex of investment companies, whether or not the broker-dealer that the exemption is to apply to is doing any other business with any of the other companies in the complex. And if there are other companies in the complex that are doing a material business with that broker-dealer, even though the applicant might be willing to say that this one fund in the complex will not do any broker-dealer business with this particular broker-dealer, we would still oppose the application because you still have that material business relationship, which gives rise to the types of questions that Sid referred to.
That's a very good point. One instance of the kind of change that's happening under the Investment Company Act study is a rule that's been promulgated under 2A19 prior to the study being formed, but in the same connection, trying to put into a rule automatic exemptive relief for those situations where we've seen recurring factual problems, none of which give us trouble. And Rule 2A5 under the Act is the one I'm referring to. It's a very limited case in terms of who it applies to, but we did find quite a number of people being caught up in the following situation. A person who's affiliated with a broker-dealer, who's a broker-dealer only because, then registered as a broker-dealer, only because they're in the business of selling investment company shares. This often is in the case of an insurance company that has variable annuities or variable life policies, which are registered under the 40 Act now, as you heard yesterday, but is registered for that purpose. So long as that's the sole business of the broker-dealer, and so long as it's not the shares of the subject investment company which are being sold, and the subject investment company is not buying those shares, those directors, even though they're affiliated with a broker-dealer, are automatically, by this rule, taken out of the definition if that's their only nexus to the 2A19 definition to be an interested person. That's the most common most common area of exemptive relief, so we're getting very few applications under 2A19 anymore. But with those that we are getting, I think we're following the guidelines that Glenn and I discussed. There's one final category of interested persons of investment companies, and that covers the consultant, the person, the consultant to the investment company, or the advisor. It's any natural person who the commission by order determines to be an interested person by reason of having had or having a material business or professional relationship with the investment company or with its principal executive officer or with any other investment company which has the same advisor or principal underwriter, basically a sister company as we've been talking about them. Now there's a presumption that no one has that in a sense, because it takes a commission order to make that finding. You're not deemed to have a material business or professional relationship until there's an order. On the other hand, I think this area is a little like the 2A9 area, where if you know you have, as Mark talked about before, if you know you have a material professional or business relationship, relying on that for purposes of being counted in as a disinterested director put you at some risk. And I think that the staff administratively has had a little difficulty in this area. I don't think we've brought any commission cases. We haven't done it through the administrative proceeding to get a commission order. But we have, when we've seen this problem arise, we've contacted the funds that are involved. Probably more often, the funds and their counsel have come to us first and sat down and explained the situation and asked what we thought and what we would do. I think they've done that in large part because this kind of proof isn't a terrifically hard case to make. Once we have the facts that somebody's getting X dollars for providing X service or is involved in a particular business enterprise with one of the subject people, the proof isn't terrifically hard. So administratively, we've handled it almost exclusively, I think, by conference or letter, saying that on the basis of the facts we have, the person either has this material relationship or doesn't. And when it doesn't, I think we've been acting in reliance on the opinion of outside counsel in addition to our review of the facts.
We had one very, very peculiar case Glenn and I worked on, American General, in which it was impossible for the commission or for the staff to request a proceedings because the business relationship was not revealed to us and was not disclosed. When it was not disclosed in the proxy material when the directors were elected. But under investigation, we found that several in the so-called disinterested directors had either American General, I might add, is a complex run by American General Insurance Company. And we found that several of the so-called disinterested directors had borrowed money either personally or for their businesses from the parent of the investment advisor, the American General Insurance Company. And these borrowings were no paltry amount. They came, in one case, over $1 million. And this person sat on the board as a disinterested director. And the quandary that the staff had here was this, that is, that a person is disinterested because of a business, a material business relationship, until the commission by order says he isn't. But here, the transaction that constituted the business relationship was neither revealed to the staff nor to the shareholders when the director was elected. And the question was, by failing to disclose, by making a misleading proxy, had this person become disinterested? Well, we took the easy way out, and we charged violations of the proxy rules and misleading proxies, which was tantamount to saying that this person wasn't even elected, because having been elected by fraud, if you will, the question as to whether he even sat on the board legally was open to question. The case was settled, but the point that I want to make is that some of these business relationships are not altogether clear to the staff or to the commission.
The reason why Sid and I had difficulty with that case is, I think, a point that Arthur's going to cover, so I won't go into detail on it, and that is, in this material business relationship part of 2A19, both in the legislative history of the amendment and number of memos to the commission, the point is made that we cannot get retroactive orders. That is to say, we are precluded from going to the commission and asking for an order making the individual interested because he entered into a material business relationship 2, 3, however many years ago. So given the fact that we could not get a retroactive order, we had to look at another way to make the case. And as Sid indicates, the way that we recommended to the commission and that the commission accepted was to say that by not disclosing these loan transactions in the annual report form to the commission and in the proxy statements to the shareholders of the American General Investment Companies, that the proxy rules were violated as well as the annual report requirements to the commission. So if you're on an inspection, or if subsequently you find information indicating that there may be a material business relationship, what you should look at, in addition to the facts of the transaction, is were these transactions disclosed both to the commission and to the shareholders?
For those who are making inspections, I would say that when you come across transactions or relationships which you have reason to believe are material business relationships, I would take those facts back to your office and discuss them with your supervisor. I think it's very important that these facts be brought to light, particularly to your supervisor.
Let me add one other situation. I think this should be distinguished from a control relationship where the commission in the past has decided that since the relationship existed retroactively, the finding is retroactive as well.
That's a very important point, and one point I should have made when we went on the control point. If we find that a control relationship exists, we can get a retroactive order there where we cannot get a retroactive order on the material business relationship point.
Can I also raise a couple points? First, just to avoid ambiguity, when we talk about a material business relationship, we're talking to material to the person who would be deemed by us to be an interested person, and not necessarily material to the fund. In other words, $5,000 or $10,000 may not rise to the level of a material transaction in dollar amounts for an investment company, but it may be deemed material in the context of an individual or his own business. The second thing, as we'll discuss a little later in the context of several rules, we have taken the concept of interested person, which statutorily was directed primarily in dealings with quasi-independent parties, such as the investment advisor, the principal underwriter, and the accountants to investment company. And we have used that as a basis for giving exemptive relief in affiliated transactions. And that has been applied, particularly within the last year, to many of our exemptive rulemaking proposals.
One last point on 2A19, and that is Sid and Glenn talk about the American General case. Our position under 2A19A6, which is the order procedure, is even worse than they may suggest, because not only can't we get a retroactive order, but any order that's issued by the Commission only takes effect 60 days thereafter. So even once the order is issued, it's not immediately effective, and it's clear that was one of the compromises of the 70 Act.
This is a the industry said, my goodness gracious, some of these things cannot be determined except by judicial hearings. Accordingly, where we honestly think a person is disinterested and he isn't disinterested, should the commission find he's disinterested, then everything he did in good faith prior to that order would be null and void. And for example, yesterday, I think it said that the majority of the disinterested directors has to select an accountant. If two of those persons out of three, for example, voted for the accountant, and the commission later finds that those two people were interested instead of disinterested, the selection of the accountant would have been void. And we'll get into later on with respect to the advisory contract. The same thing would apply there, where the advisory contract would not have been conceivably viable, because the requisite number of the board of disinterested directors on the board were not on the board at the time that the contract was approved. So the industry was able, and I think properly so, under the context, was able to persuade the Congress to put this prospective rather than retrospective application in the in this particular section.
Are there any questions on 2A19?
Art, I had one. I know in the section there's a specific exclusion for the case of a person owning securities in the investment company. And does that mean that a shareholder, say, owning 20% of the shares of an investment company, who would be an affiliated person, who would otherwise be an interested person, would not be interested?
I can answer that. A person owning shares in the fund does not make him interested. And the reason for that is, who but a guy that owns a chunk of the fund wants it to be run right? I mean, who knows better as to whether the fund should be, how the fund should be run? Who could be better qualified to pick the investment advisor dispassionately than a person who owns, whose money is at risk by that investment advisor?
Yeah. I think that's tied in very closely to Section 18 of the Act, and the restrictions on capital structure. I think we've already heard open-end companies really can only have one class of stock, and they're all voting stock. So as long as that 20% owner has the same class of stock as everyone else, or even a control person, presumptively 25%, his interest, if he does something in his interest, presumably it'll be in the interest of the entire class.
Yeah.
Okay, we've discussed the definitions, and I guess I think we spent a good deal of time on them, but they're very important as we get to the actual regulatory parts of the Act. I don't think there's really enough time to start that. I'm going to be talking first about Section 10, which talks about the board structure for an investment company.
I might just make one additional point. It relates to the affiliated person point I discussed, and that is, you remember we said that a director of an investment company is an affiliated person. Well, we can't very easily have all directors be interested persons, because that would defeat the purpose of Section 2A19. So 2A19 does contain a specific provision that says that a person will not be deemed to be an interested person of an investment company simply by virtue of his director position.
That's right. I think that this concludes the tape, and we'll start on the next tape shortly.